I wish I could figure out what's going on here.
And welcome to the Activity Continues podcast. We are your hosts. This is Amy.
And this is Megan. Thanks for joining us again. This week, Amy is recapping the Dead Files episode called Shattered. It's from season 8 and episode 13, and it originally aired on September 16th of 2017. Yeah. So why did you choose this, Amy?
Well, I think I mentioned this last time, but I was going through I have a spreadsheet of all the episodes we've done. I have a spreadsheet of all of the episodes of the show, and then I mark off which ones we've done, when, and all that. And I was glancing at it, noticing that we had only done one episode from season 8. And so I decided I wanted to do an episode from season 8. And so I just opened up Discovery, and I was kind of scrolling through, you know, the little carousel of pictures. Yep. And I really liked the picture for this one because it was creepy.
Yep. I love it. Very scientific.
Yep. Very, very scientific. So,
so excited.
So that's why I picked it. And I'm glad I did because it's good. And it takes place in New York. You know, I have a soft spot.
Oh my God. What is with you and New York?
I do have a soft spot.
You love it.
This is like rural upstate New York, though. I'm not sure I would love that as much as I love New York City.
But oh, see, I would love the ruralness of New York.
Really?
I would not. I would hate living in the city. I would hate it.
Oh,
it's too many people. There's too many people.
I know, and I'm not a real fan of people either, but no. I really loved New York City when I was
there.
Did
you?
Yeah, I really did.
No.
I don't think I could do it all the time. Every time I would need like a cabin up north or something, you know, that I could go to if I needed to.
You're getting ritzy.
Yeah.
Let's see. I've got my studio in Manhattan and then my cabin in upstate. Forget about the Hamptons in the summer.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, you can't forget about the Hamptons.
No.
Everybody who's anybody goes to the Hamptons.
Right.
I only know about the Hamptons from the show Revenge. I have no concept of what it's like at all.
Well, I'm sure it's exactly like it is on Revenge.
Oh my God, I'm sure. The TV shows never lie. Remember when I watched that and I would text you?
Yeah.
And I would have, oh my God, I loved Revenge. But man,
it's such a good show.
Breaks. I had to take breaks. It was so stressful.
Yeah. It's a little
not
anxiety.
Good for my anxiety.
Yeah.
Did you know Emily and Daniel got married in real life?
That's right. Yeah.
They're so cute.
I know. Oh, they are cute.
Precious.
And then she was just in a show that I'm not going to remember what it was, but
of course.
We were watching something, Greg and I said, oh my God, that's Revenge Girl. And it was something.
Emily. No, Amanda.
Yeah. The character was Amanda. Mm-hmm. Or was it?
No, it was Amanda.
It was two characters, didn't she?
Yeah. Her original name was Amanda, but then she told everybody her name was Emily because I guess Amanda's not ritzy enough.
Didn't and she take the place of somebody she was in prison with or something like that?
In juvie. Yeah, in juvie. Yeah. Well, she didn't take her place. She just took her name. Yeah.
I think she took her identity.
She took her name. And then when she got out and came to visit, then she was Amanda. And then Jack fell in love with her, but really he was still in love with Emily / Amanda. Uh-huh. It was seriously like a soap opera.
Such a good soap opera.
Oh my God, it was so good. And Daniel was so hot. He's British. Who knew?
Yeah.
He had a good American accent.
Yeah. I'm always surprised.
I don't even have a good American accent.
I know.
I'm American.
I'm always surprised when people that are from another country speak better than we do. I don't know why I should be. I shouldn't be.
Robert Pattinson, Edward Cullen.
Oh, yeah.
British.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When I saw him in Harry Potter, I was like, wow, he does a really good British accent. Little did I know, he was just talking.
Look at that. Just talking.
Just talking. Oh, let's see. Sorry, I derailed us with
that's fine.
I don't
fine.
Even know what.
You know, I think we're better when we're derailed.
I think we are, too. It just seems more natural.
Yeah. And that we're on TikTok. Oh, that's one thing I wanted to mention is that I started to put up audiograms.
Yes.
On TikTok. So We have a little bit of a TikTok presence. We're under Collected Sounds. I might switch it over and get us our own account. But right now, it's under
listen to us
Collected Sounds account. Yeah, come on over and give it a shot. But we had a comment that said, "Do I have to watch the Dead Files in order to listen to this show?"
No.
And Megan replied and said, "No, you don't have to." And I replied and said, "Frankly, there's more chit chat about everyday shit than there is about the Dead Files. If you look at a ratio, it's probably more of this than there is Dead Files talk."
True story. Because we'll talk about the Dead Files and then I'll be like, "Oh my God, that reminds me." And 35 minutes later.
Yeah.
Can we get the fuck back to the show?
No, because I do it too.
And Greg's poking his head in like, "Can you fucking stop? Just kidding.
You've been at this for 5 hours. Dinner's been ready.
I've got kebabs that are ready to go."
He's making dinner again tonight.
Oh, Greg. I'm officially on the website for the Harvest Howl from the Wildlife Sanctuary, the craft fair that I'm doing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I sent you a picture of it. So
I saw it. You're official. Saw
the vendors. Yes, I am on there.
Sweet.
Big day.
Sweet, sweet, sweet. Cool. Patreon.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm thinking about doing is changing up the tiers a little bit so that it's not like tier one gets this and then tier two gets that plus more and then tier three gets all those plus more. Mm-hmm. Because I kind of feel like I just want people to join at whatever level they can or wish to support us at. And then I feel like it's kind of classist to say, if you give us $3,
I don't
you get
like
more.
That. I don't.
So I think I'm going to leave it $1, $3, and $5 and just let people pick what they want. But everybody gets the same thing.
Yeah.
So
I hate that, especially like other podcasts do that. And
everybody does. And that's the way that everybody, I shouldn't say everybody, but people I support, they all do it that way.
Mm-hmm.
And there are, I can't give $5 to every single one that I like, or, I would have no money.
Right.
But
I give $5 right now to two, and I'm like, maybe three. Yeah. But the thing is, they started at five, and I'm like, can't you start it at like
Patreon wants you to start at five?
Well, Patreon can suck it. Just
that's
kidding.
Right. So anyway, I'll be changing that up. So if anybody wants to join, by the time this airs, we'll be close to the end of the month.
Mm-hmm.
This one's coming out on the 26th. So September 1st is a good time to come down and become a member.
Yep.
So that's cool. And then we are close to 1,000 followers on Instagram. So if you're not following us, come on over and follow us. And if you're a real person that has posts and doesn't look like a bot, I'll follow you back.
Yep.
And this week we hit over 4,000 downloads.
What is that's happening? I know it is exciting.
Let me just refresh one more time. F5. Oops. Okay, F5 the wrong thing. No, I didn't. Well, Audacity jumped when I hit the button, and I'm like, what did I do over there?
You're like, Audacity, settle down. Calm down.
Calm down.
Oh, sure. Calm down. Yeah.
We have 4,017.
Oh, you guys. Downloads. Oh, my God. Yep. That's amazing.
Yep, yep.
And that's my friend from work, Roxanne, she started listening a couple of weeks ago, and she said she loves us, obviously.
Oh, who wasn't?
Who doesn't love us or love us?
I think that we do have some new people that are catching up because I'm seeing a lot of like when I look at 24 hours, the past 24 hours, I see like one download for episode 3 and then episode 4 and then episode 5. So I think people are just catching up and stuff. So that's cool. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
And our podcast partners this week are Dark Tales from the Road is one podcast, and then Paranormal Exposed is another one. And Paranormal Exposed is part of the BooPod network that that we've been talking about. The other one's not, but it's a good podcast, and we're exchanging some promos.
And aren't we part of the BooPod too?
Yeah.
Yeah. Gosh darned right we are.
Yeah. Sure are.
I was like, why are we talking about the BooPod if we're not part of the BooPod?
We are.
For Pete's sake. Our mascot's a ghost.
Yes, we are.
Huka. It doesn't get more boo than that.
That's correct. Also want to remind people to review us. We haven't gotten in a review in a while, and yeah, we love
only
those.
If it's nice.
Yeah,
and don't nice be like people. these women are dumb. That would hurt our feelings.
That would hurt our feelings.
I cry very easily. So we went to a parade today. My son, we watched one, and I literally, because I was in the parade, I was in a marching band in high school.
Oh, fun.
And I almost started crying because I was like so emotional. I'm like, oh my God, this brings back so many memories. I almost started crying at a parade. So if you think I cried a parade of negative reviews, I'm going to just call Amy. That's how upset I'll be. I'll call her.
Oh, no.
And Amy will be like, shit.
This could have been a text.
Seriously. Like, if you write us a negative review, there'll just be a snowball of effects. And
it's not good. Not going to be good.
Please. So just please be like, they're funny.
Yeah.
I just wrote your review for you.
Yeah. There it is. It's simple. Very simple.
Very simple. We don't need a flowery review.
No. No.
So, yeah, please review us.
Yeah, that would be great.
And if you have constructive criticism, let us know.
Yeah, that's great.
But don't be mean about it.
Right. Kind but, constructive criticism is great.
We're open to if you want us to do something different, if you know, think if we should take something out or whatever, let us know.
Yeah, for sure.
We're here for you.
That's right. We have a couple of YouTube subscribers, so that's nice. That's been kind of going up lately. So hello to Hillbilly Hippie Paranormal.
Yes.
And Tranquil Rabies.
Okay. I love Tranquil Rabies because it's such an oxymoron.
Yeah.
Like whoever's like, oh my God, your rabies, they're so tranquil right now. So tranquil. Like you don't even know you have them. The foaming at the mouth is just so down.
Right. Right. And then the last thing I have on our notes is that we discovered a new Jocanda show.
I think I saw it. Is it called Homicide Hunter something?
It's called Never Give Up, I think.
Yeah, Homicide Hunter, Never Give Up.
Oh, is it? I didn't realize Homicide Hunter was part of the title.
I looked at it. I was going to watch it when I was taking my nap today, but I'm like, oh, this is a new Kenda. I need to watch it.
Yeah, you'll want to watch it. Also, that first episode, there's only one episode out right now.
Yep, so far.
And it is... Yep, Homicide Hunter, Never Give Up. And that one episode is an hour and a half, so it's a doozy. Oosta.
It's a doozy.
It's a good one, though. The premise is that it's...
like a cold case.
It's cold cases that were Kenda's back when he was working as a cop, and then they were picked up after he, you know, more recent times, they were picked up by the cops that are working in that precinct now and are solving these cases with... based on what he had done and new information. And sometimes, like in this one, it was DNA that the crime was in 87 and they didn't have DNA testing and stuff back then. But because Jocanda's a fucking genius, he made sure to save all of the DNA. Yep. So, because he knew someday it'll be worth something.
Yep.
So,
and he's real, Greg.
He's real. I know. Greg doesn't believe in a lot of things, but he doesn't believe that Jocanda's a real person. He thinks he's an actor and that he's an amalgam of a bunch of different policemen that existed maybe in Colorado Springs, maybe in other places. And so I'm
Gregory.
Constantly trying to
prove,
explain to him
real.
That he's a real, or that, that he was a cop.
Yeah,
he's a real ex
person
cop.
Yeah.
So, and I just realized that my Audacity just turned my sound down again. So I'm gonna have to sit real close to the microphone because that's the only way you're gonna be able to hear me.
Okay.
All right. So the content warning I have is there is some talk of rape, but it's it's only at the very end, and it's not.
Okay. Well, I did not watch the episode, so I don't have any content warnings.
Okay. All right.
Let's do it, everybody.
Let's get in.
Buckle in. Buckle in and sit down and shut up. Just kidding.
It's okay. You can talk all you want. We can't hear you.
It's true. It's like when people clap at the end of movies. What are you doing?
Oh,
what
my
are you
God. Doing? Before I quick, maybe not quick. Thursday
Nothing
night.
Do is quick, so.
Thursday night, Greg and I went to a real movie theater and saw a Riff Tracks.
I've never even heard of it.
Okay. So do you know of Mystery Science Theater, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Mystery Science Theater, when it ended, Some of the people went off and made Cinematic Titanic, and some people went off and made riff tracks.
Okay.
So it is some of the guys from Mystery Science Theater that have this thing called riff tracks. And it started out being where they would riff on movies that were popular at the time, that were out like on DVD or at Netflix or whatever.
Yeah.
And so you would purchase from them just the audio of them making the jokes so that it was no, like, there wasn't any sort of copyright thing. Right. So you watch Memento on your own.
Yeah.
And you play their track and you can sync it up. And so you play that. Anyway.
That's a trippy movie.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's pretty, pretty funny with riff tracks too.
I'm sure it is. I'll have to watch it.
Yeah. So now they do these live shows where they're in, I think they're almost always in Nashville. And they do this live show on a stage in a movie theater. And they do the riffing live. And then they have a live studio audience, usually made up of their patrons. And then they broadcast it to other movie theaters all over the country.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So it's live.
Oh, neat.
Yeah. So we went out and saw that this week. We've seen a bunch of them. We see them every time they come.
Yeah. Nice.
Anyway, it was fun.
That's exciting. Yeah.
It was fun.
You venture down into the land of the living.
Yeah, we did. And had popcorn and everything.
Oh, my God.
But what was interesting is that just because of the, like, format of the way that they're talking over the movies and I don't know, it feels more almost conversational. So people are like clapping and like hollering at the screen and stuff, and it made me think of that because I thought it was so funny that
people are doing that.
People are doing that. They're like clapping. Okay, I'm gonna pause for a second because my recording volume has gone down to half. I don't understand why. So I'm going to turn this down.
Are you a recording volume glass half girl, half full girl, or half empty?
Well, it should be at about 89.89, and it keeps going down. Was that 57? Why the fuck are you moving? Stop moving. Okay. Nope. It just moved again. It's like doing this on its own. What is happening? All right. Well, I guess hope for the best.
Yep.
Oh, it's way too low. What the fuck are you doing? Oh, now it's back up. It's just moving on its own.
Okay. Well,
yeah, that's cool.
All right.
So sorry ahead of time, guys, if this sounds like shit, but there, it just moved down again. I don't know. I think it thinks it's helping. It's not.
It's like, whoa, Amy, too fucking loud.
Not dial helpful.
It back. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, listeners, my name is Kayla, and I am the creator and host of a new podcast called Dark Tales from the Road. We cover true crime, spooky, creepy, and ghostly stories, and I want to take you state by state and country by country to bring you stories you may not have even heard of before, and also learn some history on the city and the state where it takes place. So join me on the road as we discover dark tales. New episodes are posted every Wednesday. I have an Instagram, Facebook, and a Patreon, all at Dark Tales from the Road. Thank you so much, and I hope everyone has a great day.
Okay, so this is, again, season 8, episode 13. It's called Shattered, and it originally aired September 16th, 2017. The location is Sinclairville, New York. It is a tiny town, under 600 people.
Ooh.
And it looks really depressing because this is in the middle of the winter and it's like cold.
And I bet nobody locks their doors and everybody knows everybody else.
Probably. Yeah. Probably. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It looked like a cute area. It was a cute.
I'm sure it was. Yeah.
Cute house.
And, I bet it's adorable in the fall with all the leaves.
Oh, God. I bet it's beautiful then. Yeah. Yeah. But in the winter, dead of winter. Ooh.
In the winter, it's not pretty.
I mean, it probably is like when people have Christmas lights and stuff. Yeah. But it looked really desolate and really cold.
Barren and cold. Yeah. Oh, sure. Like my uterus.
Oh, jeez.
Just kidding.
It's cold, is it?
It's cold. Yeah, it's kind of getting that looked at.
Oh my god.
Dry okay. ice everywhere. Okay. This took a turn.
Yeah, it did. I'll say. Okay, so our client is Jackie. Okay. She spells it J-A-C-Q-U-I, which I had trouble with in my notes because my stepmom's name is Jackie and I'm used to spelling it or typing it quickly. J-A-C-K-I. And so I have to go J-A-C-E-Q. I was having trouble with it.
No, no finger, not no. the C. You gotta go Q.
Over Q.
Q, way over there.
Yep, way over there.
Over yonder.
Over yonder, top left. So, and her husband, Tim, and they have two kids, Bradley, who's 8, and Phoebe, who's 6, and they are adorable.
Oh, Phoebe. I love that
They're
name.
So cute, these kids. And yeah. I'm, you know, I'm not really a kid person, no, but these kids are fucking cute.
Hashtag not a mother.
Now, I was a preschool teacher for like 7 years. I did my...
You did your time.
I did my time. I didn't want to do it forever.
Yeah.
I could hand them back and that was fine.
At the end of the day and then go home and have some wine and be like, oh my God.
Yep. Never having children.
To be fair... To be fair, you did kind of jump in the deep end with like 33-year-olds. That's a bit, that's a lot of 3-year-olds.
Oh, 33-year-olds. Like, no, they were like, 33 years old.
No, like 30 space 3-year-olds.
Yep. Yep.
That would make anybody not want to be a mother.
Yeah. I mean, I really liked being a preschool teacher. It was hilarious. It was fun. Yeah,
I'm sure.
I loved it, but 8 hours a day is as much as I can.
It's enough. That's enough. Some days I'm like, oh my God, we're done. And then I'm like, oh shit. I can't hand them back.
Yeah.
Okay, where's the mother? Oh, shit.
Oh, shit, it's me.
Shit, it's me. God damn it.
You didn't think that through.
I know. Son of a bitch. I did not plan. I am not a... I don't, you know, plan ahead. I'm not very... No, I'm not a planner. I'm very spontaneous, which is a perfect thing to do to have a kid. Just like wake up one day. Oh, my God, I should have a kid.
Yeah. Right? Why not? What could go wrong?
What? Not a thing. I can't think of anything.
Except that cold uterus.
Yeah, it's desolate.
Not that that's because you had a kid.
No, some people might say that's the good thing.
Yeah.
That desolate uterus. Just tumbleweeds. Okay. I'm so sorry.
You're too young for all of that.
Let's move on. We're like 3 sentences in.
I know. I'm still on page 1. So I'm at the end of page 1, but... So Jackie says that the activity in the house has really changed her husband. He doesn't spend time with her or the kids. Mm. And Steve asks why she thinks this is paranormal. And she said it's gone from the occasional fight to constant all the time.
You boozing?
You boozing?
You boozing?
I don't think he asked anybody that this time.
Oh, that's Steve.
I know. All right. I'm getting really mad at Audacity. It keeps going down. Sorry, guys. This episode's probably going to sound like shit. Anyway, also
we're not even drinking either.
I know. I was going to, but
I was going to, but then I'd have to go upstairs, and my son might see me, and then would be really bad.
Yeah, yeah. You need a little wine fridge down there.
Oh my God, you're so smart. See, this is why you're in charge.
Oh. Okay, Jackie's health has declined, and her husband tells her that he hears a voice in his head telling him that he doesn't love her anymore.
Oh, my God.
I know. And she's asked him what's going on, and he literally hears this voice saying, you don't love your wife anymore. And it's a male voice.
Yeah.
Steve asked if it's like this when they're not at the house. And she said, no, they went on vacation and everything was great. He even held her hand for the first time in a long time. But then they get home and it's all gone to shit again. Mm-hmm. So Steve asks why they don't leave. And she says they can't afford it. And this house is supposed to be their dream home. And they, you know, don't want to have to leave.
It's tough. I mean,
understandable.
You know, you spend $200,000-$300,000 on a house. You can't just like, well, on to the next one.
Yep. Yep.
Tough. But,
and especially like some of these people who have had to move, they're like, I don't feel right about selling this house to somebody else.
Right.
Who might have the same problems that we do. But as Amy said, just sell it to someone who doesn't believe.
Yeah.
And then it'll be fine.
Or somebody who doesn't experience it, like Steve.
Right. Right.
Because that ghost can knock on his door all day long. He ain't answering.
That's right.
Come and knock on my door. I won't answer you. Okay. You guys, I just had a nap, like literally right before this. So yeah. I am amped and ready to go.
Good, good, good. Okay. So where this is Amy's arrival. So right out the gate, she says there's something here and she calls it the drip.
Oh, gross. I hate that. Oh, I know. I hate that.
I know.
I'm picturing like molasses, just like dripping.
Something dripping. She never really describes him or why she calls it that. Mm-hmm. Or if she did it, maybe
it was cut.
Either I missed it or it was cut. Mm-hmm. But I did watch it twice. So I didn't, but I don't remember seeing it. She says it's odd looking. It's not a person. Mm-hmm. And the other dead there are unnerved by it.
That's not good.
Yeah.
What does the dead have to fear?
Yeah. Right. Well, being stuck there, I guess.
True story.
But she said this thing came up to her and like whoosh right in her face and she could see only her reflection in it.
Oh, that's freaky. Mm-hmm. So and it doesn't have any features. Mm-mm.
It just looks like you when you look at it.
Gross. I hate that. No, thank you. Mm-mm.
She said it makes you focus on your darkest truths and either you face that or you go crazy.
Super. So yeah. We've got two options and neither of them are great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So she goes upstairs and she said the whole upstairs is no good.
That's where all the bedrooms are.
Of course. Of course. So she said the drip is coming in and making them relive horrible things that happened in their lives. Matt asks how it got here or why it's here. And she says it's attracted to the living thing that sleeps in this bed. And she points to the bed in the room that she's in. She said the living person doesn't like her life and she's miserable, depressed, and emotionally unstable, and it's a female.
So I bet it's Jackie.
Jackie, yeah. Yep. So Steve and Jackie are in the living room, and she says that things disappear and reappear.
Oh, classic.
Yeah, pretty frequently. And also the daughter's stereo turned on by itself once, real loud too.
Was it boozing?
I don't know. He didn't ask. So Amy sees a teenage dead boy who is bad and does bad things to living people.
Okay.
He likes things loud, so she wouldn't be surprised if you turned on a TV or a radio real loud. Mm-hmm. He likes it because it freaks them out and gets their attention.
Okay.
So he's a little shit.
Like all teenage boys.
Right. She says he's mad and goes into as many houses as he can and rages. So he must be going to other houses nearby.
Which is interesting because you don't normally, when you have spirits, are usually attached to like one house.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that he's just kind of popping into the other neighbors. Yeah. Ooh, wow.
Yeah. She said he's also a klepto, so things will go missing or move around.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So Jackie and Steve are now in her bedroom, and she tells about how she has really bad nightmares. She had one about dogs running out from the woods. Mm-hmm. They're in a kind of rural area, and she couldn't scream. She was trying to scream and couldn't.
I hate the dreams where you can't scream.
I know.
I hate
that
them.
Paralyzing thing. Yep. Sleep paralysis. Or
mine
is
I'll try to scream and no sound will come out.
Yep. I do that too.
I hate that.
Yep.
No matter how much I try.
Yeah. I had that happen in real life to me once when I was little. Yeah. I was swinging on a swing and a bee came and landed on my arm and I was terrified of bees.
Yeah.
And I tried to scream and nothing came out. And so like nobody
could
come help me or anything because nobody knew anything was wrong.
Oh my God.
Very scary.
Scary. Yeah.
Yeah. So now we're in the laundry room and Jackie talks about a time when she was walking out of the laundry room and she was pushed. She fell and broke her nose.
Oh my gosh. Yeah,
like it pushed her hard.
Damn. And
Steve asked her to demonstrate on him.
Huh?
She pushed and he went hard. Like
he's big. Like it takes a lot to push Steve.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So she says she wakes up with bruises ranging in sizes from like a childlike hand to the size of a donut. Mm. And I wrote in my notes, donut.
I was just going to say, now I want a fucking donut.
And now I want a donut.
Damn it, Jackie. I know. Donuts are so good. State Fair's coming up soon. The Great Minnesota Get Together.
Yep. Yep.
No thanks.
Yeah. We don't go.
It's too many people.
It's too people-y.
Too people-y.
Far too people-y.
I don't like it.
I don't either.
Anyways, donuts are good. Okay. So donuts with chocolate icing and sprinkles. Chef's kiss. That's it. That's the donut. I'm not entertaining any other thoughts, any other contenders for the best donut. I love all donuts, but that's the top of the donut tier.
That's a really good one. Yeah.
It is a good one.
I also like the ones that are that have the vanilla like pudding inside.
Oh, like the custard?
Like the Boston cream pie kind. Yeah.
I like those, but if we're talking about fillings, I prefer like raspberry or strawberry jelly.
Okay.
But like I'm not going to say no to a donut.
You know what? Almost any donut will do for me.
Donut will do.
They're my downfall.
ADWD. Any donut will do.
Yeah. That should go on a shirt or.
Oh, yeah. Or a sticker.
Do your cricket thing. And
I'll try to do. I need to. I've not cricketed for a while.
I forgot to sign you the Lugos guy. I'll do that.
Oh, Puka.
Yeah. Puka. Puka is his name.
Mm-hmm. Ghost stains his game. Okay, I'm done.
Yeah. Oh, funny. So okay. Her daughter had a dream about a snake and she kept rubbing her neck. And then when she woke up, she had bite marks on her neck. And I have a picture of that.
Oh, my God.
And I will post these on the socials.
That's so scary.
I know. Steve asks her what she wants from all this. And she says she just wants her family back and she wants her husband to be who he used to be.
Mm-hmm.
So Amy and Matt are in Jackie and Tim's room.
Mm-hmm.
And she sees the teenage boy at the end of the bed. He likes to lift up and drop the bed.
Okay, great. Yeah. I hate that.
And then Amy's voice changes a little and she says, the person brought that thing, the drip.
So the person, like somebody
in that room.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
She says,
oh, yeah, because you find that scary, I guess. So he hates whoever's here. In this space, they want this person gone.
Okay, great.
So now we're back to Steve. He is talking to Tim in the garage,
of course,
of all places.
Yep.
And Tim agrees that he's changed. He said he always used to be happy, wanting to go out and help people and stuff, and it's all changed. He talks about the voice telling him that he doesn't love Jackie anymore, and he talked about the pain he sees in her eyes when he does tell her about it. But so then Steve, in his Steve-ness, goes.
All right. So man to man, is it just trying to get out of marriage or what?
No, I love my wife.
That's a very valid question.
It is. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking like he'd admit that, you know, on camera.
Yeah.
His wife's going to see it. But no, he says, no, he loves his wife.
Yeah.
Steve asks about the voice that he hears and he said it's a man and he hears it every day.
Oh, my God. Every day?
Every day. And it just started last year when Jackie had surgery. They thought she had a heart attack. And she's young. I mean, this is a young family.
Yeah.
She can't be. I don't think she's more than 30.
She can be a day over 30.
I don't think so. If she is, she looks great.
Yeah.
But
what's her skincare routine, Jackie?
Yeah. But so that's surprising to me that she had a heart attack. She looks healthy. You know, she's not.
Well, how many spirits have we read about that cause heart attacks and cause heart issues?
So crazy.
I mean, one guy I remember I did a case, he died at like 37.
Uh-huh. Yep.
From a heart attack. Mm-hmm. So it happens.
It does. It's scary.
Silly spirits.
Yeah. So he started hearing voices right after that. And he said his health has gone down too. He's been in the ER 4 to 6 times, he said, with the feeling of having a heart attack. And Steve asked, like, what happens? Are they, you know, what did the doctors, you know, what tests do they do? And he said, they can't find anything wrong. They do all sorts of tests and nothing. Mm-hmm. Hook them up to all these machines, nothing. And Steve asked him to describe how it feels. And he said, it's pressure in his chest. And then he feels a tingling in his left arm. And Steve goes, oh, yeah, I know what that is. I suffer from the same thing. And like,
Steven, so you've had heart attacks? Steve, we need to have a talk.
I know.
You are not allowed to get sick at all or injured or anything.
No.
What?
So Tim feels like he's losing control of everything.
I'm sure. Oh, buddy.
So now Amy and Matt are going outside and she's reading from her book. So I assume that this is a woman that she saw earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Like maybe she's not seeing her at the second.
Yeah.
But
or like she visited her when she opened herself up or something like that.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. And she said the woman was burned as a witch in 1692.
Stop burning people as witches. I know. We have, but like, come on.
I know. Really awful.
I'm so angry.
So the left side of her face is burnt. The right side is normal. She's very powerful and is attached to the land.
Mm-hmm.
And she feels like she has to hunt
people. Okay.
She makes Amy feel
sad. Where did that come from?
Yeah. She makes Amy feel sad and angry. Mm-hmm. The witch is making the living woman feel sick. Nausea, mm-hmm. fevers, and a hot sensation in her mouth and throat.
Mm.
Like burning.
Yep.
And
yep.
she said it's like a fever, but on the inside of your body, which is where a fever is, isn't it?
It's a fever.
I put in parentheses. Fever, that's called menopause.
Me. Fever all through the night.
I love that song.
Fever. I do too.
I give her my fever.
Ow.
Bow, bow. It's a sexy song.
Fever when you hold me tight.
Fever.
Okay, fever.
Okay.
Anyways, moving on.
Now, Steve's talking to Phoebe, the little girl. She's six and a super cutie.
Oh, my God. I love her already.
She's so cute.
Yeah.
She has a cute little voice like this.
Of course she does. Yeah. Was her hair in pigtails?
No, it was down. It was blonde and messy. And she was just kind of like sitting on her bed and a little nervous. And
Oh my God. Steve is so good with the little kids.
He is really good
with the
kids.
He really is.
Yeah.
He's so good with them.
Yeah. He's really sweet.
Oh, Steve.
So she tells Steve that she has nightmares where she's getting kidnapped.
Oh my God.
She didn't talk about the snake, but
yeah.
He asks,
do you want to stay here?
No, I want to go to a different house.
But she said, if you could get rid of all of the scary stuff and get these ghosts out of here, I could stay. But she says, if they don't go away, I would leave the house.
Sweetie.
I know. And then Amy and Matt are in the bedroom, and I assume it's Phoebe's room. And Amy says, terrible nightmares. The witch, she looms. And that's when the person freaks out. She said the person wakes up and there's an old lady right in her face, like inches away.
I hate that. Pick on someone your own size, lady.
I know. And Matt clarifies. So they're seeing this witch when they're awake. And Amy says, yes, they may think they're having nightmares, but they're not.
Does she know it's a kid?
She didn't say that she knew at the time.
She probably does.
She probably does.
Yeah.
So Steve's now talking to the son, Bradley. He's eight. He's another cutie. And Steve asks him if it's okay in his room. And he said, no, this is the worst room. He even has his sister sleep on the floor sometimes.
Oh, what a good big brother.
Yeah. So over Steve's shoulder, I don't know if you can see the picture, but over Steve's shoulder, you see a little cut out doorway, like a little kid sized doorway. And the door is open and it looks like it's like an attic space.
Okay.
And there are beams on the floor and it looks like insulation. And it just looked really spooky and they weren't saying anything about it for a while. And I'm like, can we talk about what's over Steve's shoulder there?
Hang on, let me. Oh, yeah.
Creepy little room in the kid's bedroom.
I'm sure it's open.
Yeah.
And Steve's like, oh, let's just ignore this. What?
Well, they do talk about it, but not right away. And I was like, can we just.
I'm sure that poor kid having that open is freaking him out.
Probably is. Yeah.
Wow.
So he says he hears voices every day. Steve asks if it sounds like kids or adults. And he said it sounds like all of them. Steve asks where the voices are coming from. And the kid points to the door.
Super.
And they show the room, and there's another picture I put in of the actual attic space.
No, thank you.
Yeah.
It
looks really creepy.
Just barricade it.
Yeah. And Steve asks if they're talking to him or if he's just overhearing them. And he says,
they were talking to me because I'm the only one that can hear them.
Oh, I hate that.
Mm-hmm. He says he sees a little girl standing at the top of the stairs leading up to that second floor. And she just stares at him. And she's in a long dress down to her feet, and she's about his age. And Steve asks how often he sees her, and he says 3 to 4 times a week.
That's so often.
I know. And so then Steve asks if he ever tries to talk to her, and he says, no, because I usually don't talk to people unless they say something first. And Steve kind of chuckles, and then he asks if it scares him, and he says, yes, it's the creepiest thing I've seen.
Which indicates he's seen a lot.
Uh-huh. And then Steve asks if he wants to stay, and he says no. He likes the house, but he just can't deal with it anymore. So now Amy and Matt are headed downstairs to the basement, and she says she sees the witch, but she sees her young. And the witch says she has to hunt living people.
Why? Does she say why?
Well, Amy says she hunts people that remind her of the people who killed her. Liars, gossips, and religious fanatics.
Oh, well, crap. I'm a gossip, so.
I know, so am I.
Don't come at me.
Yeah. She hunts them and makes their lives miserable by causing them to do bad things. And she said,
it's fun for her to torture those kinds of people.
I mean, I get it.
Yeah.
You know, if that's the kind of people who tortured her.
Yep. That's right.
But like, wouldn't you want to rest? Like, you're spending an eternity.
Yeah.
Just angry.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I've never been burned at the stake, so I don't know.
Yeah.
But I can, that's true. But yeah. Oh, geez, that's really tough.
Yeah. So now Steve is in town. He's meeting with a genealogist.
Not a gynecologist.
Her name is Tina Scott. And she tells him about the Passenger family who owned the property from 1956 to 1973 and that their son, Andrew, he was a real problem. Uh-oh. So this incident took place in 1940 when he was 18. So this was before his parents lived on the property. But this just gives us an idea what a shit stain he was. It was Halloween night, 1940. Andrew was with another friend who was about 19 and they were cruising. They came upon a girl.
I hate this story. I don't want it.
They catcalled her and were trying to get her into the car because, of course, that works.
Yep.
She wasn't buying it. And so that pissed him off.
Right, of course.
Of course.
Why can men take no? They can't. Right.
No. So they got mad and he got out of the car and tried to pull her into the car. So basically kidnapping.
Kidnapping. Yeah. And he's God arrested. Knows what else.
Yeah.
Well, we know what else.
If. Well, right. He was arrested and sentenced to 6 months in jail. And then there was the genealogist, Tina Scott. I don't know if I said her name.
You did.
She shows him a picture or she shows him a cutout from an article in the magazine. And it says two youths get salty sentence for disorderly conduct on Halloween.
Okay, that's not disorderly conduct. Disorderly conduct is when you're running around like kicking over trash cans.
Right.
This is attempted kidnapping.
Exactly.
That's not disorderly conduct. No. Stop making excuses for people who are men.
Exactly. I know. So he got 6 months, which doesn't seem like very much. His friend only got 30 days.
Of course, because he was just the driver.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, that's true. He could have stopped it, certainly.
Yeah.
Or maybe he was totally down, you know?
Right.
Who knows?
Right.
But anyway, after he gets out, this Andrew, in 1942, he's out again. And again, in a car, he hits and kills a 70-year-old man.
Oh, my God.
So later that year, he married. Oh, he didn't get in any trouble for that.
No, of course not.
No. So later that year, he married Elaine Dyers.
Oh, poor Elaine.
She had just turned 14. When they got married. He'd be about 20 or 21 at this point. Well, they have three children. But then Elaine gets sick. We don't know what from, but she died in 1956 at the age of 28. Yep.
14?
So she shows, Tina shows Steve the obituary, and it doesn't state how she died either. They really don't know. I did a little search in newspapers.com to see if there was, like, I couldn't even find her obit. I couldn't find anything with her name in it. So I got bupkis. I don't know. I don't know what she died from. So Andrew does not take her death well, and his parents are now living on this property, so he moves in with them. And then he passed away in 1963 at the age of 41 from rectal cancer. Good. So I think he got what he deserved.
Yeah, I think karma got him.
That's a bad one. So she shows him the death certificate. And so he lived in that house for 7 years before he died. His mother had to raise his kids.
Of course.
Yeah.
Oh, they had kids? Oh, that's right. You said they had three.
Kids.
Yep.
So Amy and Steve are still in the basement. And, Amy and Steve. I wrote Amy and Steve.
Jackie?
Amy and Matt.
Oh, okay.
This is the Amy section. Amy and Matt are in the basement, and she sees a dead family. She sees the mother, who has three kids, and they were here a long time ago. She said the kids all died close to the same time. Boom, 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 right after one another.
Yeah.
The mom is nervous and doesn't trust people. She was married when she was 14 and died of an illness.
Wow.
Matt asks how old she is, and she says she hears 28 or 29. Which is when this woman died.
Yeah, when she died.
She sees them all hiding in the corner, but she doesn't know who they're hiding from.
Andrew?
Probably. But yeah. I'm confused because the children, they grew up. They didn't die as children.
Maybe there's other children.
They might be different children. Maybe this isn't Maybe this isn't Elaine.
Or maybe it's residual.
Yeah, I guess it could be. I mean, I guess when you even if they died when they were, 40 years old, they could decide to come back and haunt as children.
Yeah.
So Steve's headed to the library and he says, searching through old records, aka digging through the archives. He finds the Strong family, who also owned the client's land. The family is connected to a murder that happened less than a mile away. So what was that?
Something just broke upstairs.
Oh, it sounded like a hiss, like a psh.
Sounded like glass.
Oh. Uh-oh. Oh, there's something else.
Hang on, let me go check.
Yeah. Scary.
Hey guys, this is Michelle, and I want to first of all thank you all for checking out this podcast. You may be wondering what you were in for tuning into a podcast called Paranormal Exposed. Well, let me tell you what you're going to get on this ride. First off, I am a skeptical want-to-be believer in the paranormal. I'm going to be looking into various paranormal stories and give you all the information that you can possibly handle. You will get the history behind your favorite stories, along with some stories you might never have heard of. So, of course, this isn't a history podcast. It's a paranormal one. So, of course, I'm going to present the haunted reports, as well as any photographic video evidence or any of that I find along the way. All the episodes will feature stories based in the United States, and I will cover various paranormal phenomena. So join this skeptic every Wednesday wherever you tune into podcasts, and together we will find the truth and expose the paranormal to be real or not.
All right. Sorry about that.
No, that's okay. So Stig.
That was. Are you Steve. Sure you're not drinking?
That was Steve and Dig. Well, I got water. Maybe
who's
I should.
Dig?
I was mixing Steve and Dig from Digging Through the Archives.
Oh, okay, got it. Stig. Yeah. Stig. Okay.
So while he's digging through the archives, he finds the Strong family who owned the client's land. Okay. The family is connected to a murder that happened less than a mile away. So he goes in to meet local sheriff Joseph Geras. They didn't say it out loud, so I don't know how it's pronounced. Mm-hmm. Sorry if I screwed that up, Mr. Sheriff. In 1897, Axel Lawson lived with the Strong family, and he was found murdered on May 27th, 1897. He'd been beaten badly by a blunt instrument. He was 33 years old, and the sheriff handed Steve a drawing of the guy, and he was a produce peddler. He went between Sinclairville and nearby Jamestown.
Oh, he looks creepy.
Yeah, he does kind of look creepy. So Sheriff then shows Steve a sketch that was in the papers of the crime scene. And below the photo, it says, drawn from a photograph taken yesterday for the Courier Record by H.C. Drake of Sinclairville. So they took a photograph and then somebody drew it to put it in the newspaper, which is interesting to me. I guess that's how they did things in the 1890s.
Yeah.
So he'd been pretty badly beaten, and they collected 17 pieces of his skull at the crime scene.
What?
So, yeah, they basically recreated it, it looks. But, yeah, that's his body.
Okay.
So the two suspects
are... So they're all just, posing with this body?
Yeah, I guess they're all standing around looking at it.
Oh, my God. Okay.
They're probably all... You know how it was back in the day. Everybody would,
They'd make a day of it.
Yeah, and it's the newspaper reporters that are first on the scene, and they're standing around there poking at the body and everything. Yeah.
I mean, you dead? Hey,
yeah. It's amazing that that
anyone got convicted of anything.
I know. Every crime scene was contaminated.
Yeah.
So the two suspects are Fred Page, who's 50, and his son-in-law, also named Fred Romer, who's 35. And apparently the two Freds tried to pawn Axel's watch off in a pawn shop in Fredonia, which kind of made me laugh because Fred went to Fredonia.
That sounds like a kid's book. Fred and Fred went to Fredonia to find some friends.
to pawn off a watch. They
to pawn a watch.
Took off a dead guy they killed.
Five-year-old's like, what does pawn mean, mommy? Well, Fred.
Okay, so they were held but released for insufficient evidence. Steve suggested that maybe they were either well-liked or well-connected in the community and someone didn't want them to go down. So now we're back to Amy. She and Matt are still in the basement. She says she feels like her stomach just dropped. And she's seeing three dead bodies. One of them got his head bashed in by a rock. There's another person she can't get anything about. And then there's an old man. She thinks he was a farmer. And she's seeing 1910 to 1950s. She said all hell broke loose. And she sees the kid's head get bashed in. Now, I'm not sure what this is, but Axel was 33 when he had his head bashed in. So not necessarily a kid. And the elder Fred was only 50, which I wouldn't call elderly. So I'm not sure if these are the people she's seeing.
Well, maybe though, you know, they said that they can, she said multiple times, they can come back however they want.
That's true. Like, and maybe, like we were just saying, maybe those other people came back as
kids.
Yeah,
so maybe, but, you know, the guy who got his head bashed in came back as an older man because he never got to live to become an older man.
Well, he's the one that she says.
Oh, the kid. I mean, yeah. The kid. Yeah.
So I don't know. I don't know. It's weird because then she says the farmer's angry. He goes into fits of rage. And
he just keeps saying it was a very bad day.
But I'm confused about who that is, too, because the farmer in that time frame is Andrew Passenger. But he wasn't hit in the head with the rock. That was Axel who was hit in the head with the rock. So, and neither of them were kids. So I don't know. I'm confused. But
yeah.
Anyway, now Steve sits down with Michelle Henry, who's an anthropologist, who says there is, there is a Native American grave site there, or there was.
No.
It was 3 acres, and it was a big mound. It was one of those big mound burial sites.
Yeah, like a burial mound.
She said it was believed that it was the Erie tribe that were there in the 1600s. And since it wasn't a natural landscape, the people who settled there in 1825 removed 50 human skeletons. And then about 30 years later, another 25 were removed.
Okay. Yeah. Don't do that.
Don't be fucking with their shit. These bones were all sent to museums throughout New York and some were displayed locally. She shows a picture of one of the displays, which is in there, you can see. It's just a shelf with bones on it, but it's really creepy. And I noted that caption underneath it says prehistoric bones.
Oh, that's not prehistoric.
No, that's not prehistoric. So Steve asks, the Native Americans think this is disrespectful? Like, he's not really sure.
Yeah,
and
they
she
do,
says,
Steve.
Absolutely.
Of course, Steve.
Yeah.
Of course. You dig them up from their resting places and display them like, you know, collectibles. These were human beings.
Yeah. So now Amy's she's still in the basement. She's crouched down really low and she says there's something wrong with the land here. There's too much death and too many weird deaths.
There's something here
keeping the dead people here trapped.
That's a theme. I mean, the last couple ones we did had somebody, an entity that was
keeping them.
Dead people. Yeah.
Yeah.
She's confused why the dead are not leaving. And so Steve and Michelle, he's asking her about the Erie tribe and asked, what do we know about them? And she said they occupied this area through the 1600s. They were in a long-running war with the Iroquois, who burned their villages and slaughtered their people, men, women, and children.
Not the babies.
Yeah. In 1680, the Erie tribe had been forced from Western New York completely, mostly because most of them were dead.
Right, right.
So now they show Amy and Matt going back up the basement stairs, and Matt asks her to expand on what's happening with the land, and she thinks that probably has something to do with the witch. She said she tainted the land, and she's doing something to prevent people from moving on, and it's causing bad things to happen. Matt asks what would happen to the living who spent a lot of time here. She says if people are susceptible to depression or violence, it could exacerbate it.
Oh, no.
The people that she hunts, that the witch hunts, would have a bad, very bad experience with her directly. So now we're on to sketches. And Amy says the two that concerned her the most are the dead teenage boy who lifts up the bed and drops it and the witch.
The witch.
I was bummed that she didn't draw the drip because I really wanted to see what the drip looked like.
Right.
So Tim and Jackie are in the reveal. And Steve explains that the whole family is being terrorized, but it's the marriage they're most worried about. Amy talks about the laundry room, which is upstairs. When they were in the laundry room, I thought they were in the basement. Yep, it was upstairs. She explains this tiny woman and her three children says she was married around 14 and died between the ages 28 and 29. She's very protective of her kids, who are very rambunctious. Mm-hmm. They hang out in the crawl space in Little Dude's room.
Mm-hmm. In Bradley's room.
Mm-hmm. And she says you'll hear laughing and running around and stuff. And I put in my notes, I'm not sure why, I don't get why they're kid ghosts when they died as adults, but
yeah,
we already kind of covered that.
Right.
So Jackie says that Bradley has seen a little girl up there, about 11 years old. And Steve talks about the passenger family. He talks mm-hmm. about how Elaine had just turned 15 when she got married. And mm-hmm. Amy's face, she just went.
I know, I saw the screenshot, like, same Amy.
She talks about the teenage boy who's very angry, and they would experience him with noise, like TVs or radios going on, and talked about how things go missing, and everyone's like, mm-hmm. yep, that tracks. Tim says that when the radio turned on full blast, it was mm-hmm. unplugged.
That's the freakiest. Yeah.
Maybe it had batteries, but still.
Still.
Amy says that he's starting to become more physical, and she sees him shaking the bed. So this is the first sketch. And it's kind of hard to see, but you can see that there's a person on the bed.
Yep. Oh, that's scary.
With blonde hair. And the uh-huh. whole family's blonde. Or the girls. Yep. Or the, Jackie and the kids are both blonde. Mm-hmm. And then this teenage boy is lifting up the bed and dropping it.
Mm-hmm. That's really scary looking.
As Steve is pulling the thing out of there, he goes, oh, that's kind of creepy. And it's he sets Steven. It down. And Jackie says,
that's exactly what it looked like.
Mm-hmm. And she says how he held her down in the bed from behind. Mm-hmm. And Steve said,
now this stuff is in your dream.
It might not be a dream.
So he could actually be holding her down and having that physical contact with her. And this at this point, Jackie gets really upset. Yeah. Like she's hyperventilating.
Yeah.
That was my nightmare a couple months ago.
And everybody's looking like, is she going to pass out or what?
Right, right.
It was bad.
Someone get her a paper bag.
Yeah, yeah. God, I hope they have psychologists or psychiatrists and medical staff yeah. with them the whole time.
I hope so.
Ugh. So Jackie says she wakes up with bruises on her arms and legs, and Amy just nods. And Tim talks about how Phoebe woke up with that bite on her neck after the snake dream.
Mm-hmm.
And then they sort of move on from that. And Amy talks about being in the bedroom and she felt someone experiencing a lot of unhappiness. Mm-hmm. She said these negative emotions have attracted this entity that she refers to as the drip. Mm-hmm. It's never been human. Mm-hmm. And she says it is all black and shiny, but when you look at it, you see your own face. Mm-hmm. And it's forcing you to look at yourself and your darkest truths. It makes mm-hmm. you focus on things you've done that you're not proud of. And it makes the person really unstable, constantly ill, and can trigger PTSD events.
Mm-hmm.
And Tim and Jackie are both looking at each other like,
yeah. Check, Amy's, check.
Amy says the dead here are terrified of this thing. She says one or both of them have attracted it, so the dead are pissed off, and they want Tim and Jackie out of there. Tim talks about how after Jackie's heart attack, and as soon as he says heart attack, Amy's eyes go wide and she says, what?
Amy, I'm sure that's par for the course at this point.
I know. But because Jackie seems so young, you know,
right,
maybe having
right.
heart attacks when you're 20 something.
Yeah.
So, and Amy goes on, or Tim goes on to say how he hears voices that tell him that he doesn't love Jackie. Mm-hmm. Steve tells him to tell Jackie what he really feels, and bravo, Steve. This was so sweet. He tells, you know, tell her how you really feel now that we're mm-hmm. all here. And mm-hmm. he says, I love you and I want to be with you for the rest of my life. It's so sweet. I was just bawling.
Yeah.
And they hug. And Steve says, I bet you haven't hugged and kissed like that in a long time. It was so
Steve.
Sweet. I know.
Retired NYPD homicide detective and relationship fixer.
Yep. So Jackie mentions she hasn't even really cried since the heart attack. And Amy mm-hmm. asked how long ago was this event? And Jackie said a year ago. And Amy said that's the drip was probably initially attracted to or by mm-hmm. her.
Mm-hmm.
And as if that's not enough, Amy okay. says the land is contaminated. Steve talks about how settlers excavated the burial ground and yep. shows a picture of the bones and asks if yep. this is why the land is bad. And Amy goes, this one's a little different. And she talks about the witch.
Yep.
That she placed a curse on the land somewhere in the late 1600s. She was burned and now she mm-hmm. has to hunt. Amy talks about how the hate that she feels with Tim and Jackie, and Tim talks about his heart issues. Mm-hmm. Amy says she's capable of projecting herself in any way she wants and is worried that she's showing herself as a little girl to the son. So that little girl that he sees there staring at her could be this. Could be the
No, that's bad. Yep. That's really bad.
Yep. So then the next sketch is how she presented herself to Amy, the witch, that is.
Scary. Steve. I didn't like that one.
No. Steve pulls it out and goes, that's pretty fucked up looking.
Steven.
I know.
Yes.
And it's, literally, it's this woman who looks like she was probably pretty. Mm-hmm. And, you know, half of her face is normal and the other half is
totally fucked up.
Totally burnt. It's like burning flesh and then like a hollow eye. Like a
hollow eye.
And then like neck.
You could see her neck bones. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. It's really gross. So she wants them out because they have the drip and she doesn't want to deal with it or him. So she's trying to split them up as a way to get them out of the house.
Uh-huh.
She says she is the one who's telling Tim he doesn't like Jackie. But as we said, she can present herself however she wants. So it's coming across as a male voice. Even though it's a woman.
It's her. Yep.
So Jackie now says this is all her fault. She brought this stuff here. And Amy says, why do you feel that way? And Jackie says that when she was 14, she was raped. And she says, I had no one. And after that, everything I did was a lie.
Oh, my God, Jackie.
And I don't know what she means by that necessarily, but I guess because of that trauma, she mm-hmm. behaved in a way that was not like her and maybe mm-hmm. caused problems for some people. Because it sounded like Amy was almost like blaming her, you know, she feels like she's blaming herself, but it kind of seemed like Amy was kind of like, oh, why do you feel that way? And like, why, you know?
Right.
And then when she comes out with she was raped, I was like, well, that's not her fault.
No.
But yeah, so I don't know. God. Either it was really, I feel like that section was really highly edited and that maybe mm-hmm. Jackie said more mm-hmm. about what she may have done.
I'm sure she did.
Wrong.
Yeah.
That they cut
or she whatever. Didn't do anything wrong. But
no, but I mean, if she reacted later mm-hmm. in later years, did something bad that mm-hmm. because of the trauma, mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it just seemed weird for Jackie to answer like that. And I don't know. I don't know. But anyway.
Yeah.
So the solution, the drip. Jackie needs to seek therapy regarding the rape and process it mm-hmm. and really process those things. And she said anything else that's haunting her. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if this is what Amy was maybe referencing to when she asked Jackie why she thought it was her fault.
Yeah.
Maybe she did do something.
Maybe she did do something.
Not great.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Amy said it would be extremely difficult to move on the witch and the teenager. She suggests they don't stay in the house.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Wow. So she says there's hundreds of years of contamination. It would be super hard to wipe it away.
Yeah.
It's going to be hard and stressful, but they have to, you know, do the therapy and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And they're relieved and they thank Amy and Steve. And then the ending mm-hmm. recap, follow up says Tim and Jackie are searching for a new home and the activity continues.
Oh my God.
So I really want an update
at the end of the day.
I know.
Or at the end of the episode.
I know. I really want an update on these two.
Yeah.
Which brings me to the other thing I wanted to talk about is, and I want, you know, we want listeners' input on this too. And I posted about this on our socials mm-hmm. today.
Yeah, I saw.
As we know now, the Dead Files is coming to an end. Next season is going to be the last one.
Yep.
And so we have to think about where we want to go from here mm-hmm. if we want to keep doing. I mean, it's not like we don't have a ton of episodes to cover because it was on for 14 years. So. Right. We do have enough episodes to keep us going, but do we want to keep doing it? Because part of the reason I wanted to do this anyway is to bring new viewers to the show.
Yeah.
And if it's going to be off the air, I guess there's really no point in doing that.
Yeah.
But so do we want to keep doing that? Do we want to do a different show? Mm-hmm. Do we want to? What I would really like to do, if I thought it were possible, is I would like to have this be like a follow-up.
Yes.
No.
And we get the people who are on the show.
Clients. Yeah. Yeah. People who had called Amy and Steve in for help and do a follow up, do an interview with the family or with one or two of the people and, you know, have them as a guest on the show, talk about what you know, what's been happening, what it was, if they can mm-hmm. talk about mm-hmm. how the recording was and all yeah. that stuff, that yeah. would be super interesting.
Yeah,
it's possible they can't say too much.
Right.
But I would like to definitely get updates on, like,
yes,
you know, if they did all the things Amy suggested, did it work? Mm-hmm. And if it did work, did it work forever, or did it mm-hmm. ever come back, or did you mm-hmm. move, or, you know, all yep. that kind of stuff?
Or so, did other spirits come and maybe yeah. not the original,
someone else show up? Yeah,
yeah.
So, and I think, judging from the Facebook groups I'm in of people that watch this show, mm-hmm. everybody wants updates on these people. Yeah, you know, yeah. you've spent an hour watching them and you mm-hmm. get invested.
At least once. Like, yeah. and I'm sure the people watching it are watching more than one episode.
Sure.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, only for myself, but I believe a lot of people that watch this show feel the same way. We really yeah. care about these people. And we yeah. want to know what happens to them.
What happened to them. Yep.
If you happen to be listening, any of you were clients on this show and you want to discuss, or you know somebody who is, and tell them about it. We would love to
yeah.
to talk with you.
And we, I mean, if you want to remain anonymous, we can yep. change your name. We don't have to say what episode it was.
Yeah. Yep. We can do that too. It doesn't have to be a Zoom.
Everything.
Yeah. It can just be a phone call. You
know, yep. I was on the show.
Yeah.
This is what happened. This is, you know, if yeah. you want to do that, we can totally do that. Yep. We don't have to be like, hey, this is Bob from season one, episode one.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah. I think his name was David, but
the season one, episode guy. One, the dandelion,
the dandelion guy.
Oh, he's yeah. not coming on the show. We made too much fun of him.
We did make a lot of fun of him. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. But yeah, so we would love that.
Yes. So thanks for joining us, everybody.
Yes. Thank you.
Megan, you're up next week. Do you yep. want to tell the lovely people what you're doing?
I sure do. I'm presenting Hell in the Heartland, which is season 8, episode 1. And this was actually a suggestion from one of our listeners, and his mm-hmm. sign is @Jim1062. Mm-hmm. And he tweeted at us asking if we'd done this one, as it was his favorite. So since Amy did the last listener suggestion by Carrie, it is my turn to do this. So that's why we're doing it. We're just knocking out season 8. Boom, boom, boom,
boom, boom, boom. And I did watch this one mm-hmm. yesterday. Mm-hmm. It's a doozy.
Okay. All
right. I see why it's his favorite.
Do I have to watch this in the day?
Yeah, it's a doozy. It's got all everything.
Right. I'll watch it in the daytime.
Yep, yep. So if there's anyone else out there, if there's a favorite episode of the Dead Files that we have not covered and you would like
and you us want us to cover sooner rather than later, yeah. reach out.
Shoot us a email or message mm-hmm. or DM, or there's mm-hmm. a million ways to reach us. They're all mm-hmm. in the show notes. So mm-hmm. cool. That's what we love.
That's
we'd
the
love
show. To hear well, from thanks. You. Thanks, everybody.
Yep. Thanks for joining us. Thank you for listening to the Activity Continues podcast. We really appreciate you giving us your ears for a bit. Please reach out if you have a suggestion for which episode of The Dead Files we should cover next, or if you have a spooky story you'd like us to share on the show. We can be reached at theactivitycontinues@gmail.com or through our website or any of our socials. Links are all in the description of the show. Please feel free to drop us a note and say hi. And join us next time when the activity continues. The Activity Continues is produced by me, Amy, at Collected Sounds Media, and is part of the independent Collected Sounds Podcast Network. We are also proud members of the BooPod network of super cool podcasts.
Nailed it.